So in a way, kind of, Swami has been with us ever since. However, you know, you can't overcome your karmas. You have to go through your karmas. And that's exactly what happened with all of us. We got through the school years. Immediately, I had to find a job because every penny was important for us. But we did. We did get a job. We started working. And at the same time, I started my education, further education. I did my graduation from the Delhi University, continuing work. And then I did my post-graduation diploma in HR management. And I worked in all kinds of private organizations. I even went to London for 2 years, working in a private organization. I did not like because of the principles. They were not just honest. So I quit. My colleagues, fellow colleagues are still there, become a UK citizen. I'm in touch with them. But I just chose. It was time for me to wind up. I returned back in 1985. When I came in 1985, I had no job. And I was just wondering what to do. I knew nobody. I just walked into WHO, World Health Organization, 1985. I said, I spent 2 years in England, and I'm here. I need a job. And they looked at my CV and they said, there are a couple of tests that you need to do. I mean, simple English test, a typing test. Those days, the typing was important for everyone. And a general knowledge test. I said, sure. You asked me what is it. So he gave me three sets of papers. I did those things. And in Hindi, he said, aapka speed to bahut acha hai. Typing speed. Aapka speed bahut acha hai. I said, I know. My speed is good because I started learning in 10th class, even before leaving school. That was the precondition. My mother said, you have to go and start learning typing. Start learning shorthand because that's the way you can get a job. The moment there was no talk of further education at all. You said, no, you need to get a job. So I said, I know I'm good in my typing now. So I got a job. He says, okay, we have a contract job for a month. I said, fine, I will take it. That's how my UN career started. But then my work ethic was such. It's all Swami's grace. I did very well, and then within 6 months, I got a UNDP permanent job. And there was no turning back since. 1986 January, I joined UNDP on a regular contract, permanent contract. And I retired in 2016 from the United Nations. In between, I was deputed to many, many countries. The first posting was I immediately got, in 1986, I went to Kyrgyzstan and all for a short period, CIS countries, because I was good in my accounts software that was introduced in UN. I was good, so I had to go there and train the people there. That was only for 3 months, so I came back to Kyrgyzstan. Very cold, you know, it was minus 20. It was the first time I was stepping out of home, and minus 20. And the room, there was no much electricity. CIS was really poor country after the breakaway of the Russian Federation. CIS countries were really in pieces and they had no electricity at all. Cold. I used to sleep with my overcoat on. And I used to make my own food because you don't understand the language. Second, you just can't get any vegetarian food there. So I had to prepare my own food. Of course, that food was only palatable only to me. Nobody else would eat that. But it's okay. I'm managing. Then the break came in 1991. The first long-term break was in Western Sahara. The UN peacekeeping operations, which is still going on right now. Western Sahara, I don't know how many of you know, it's a 1700 kilometers of pure, pristine desert. 1700 kilometers and is a disputed area. Spanish occupied it, they left in 1996, and since then it has been a disputed area. The original Sahrawians, as they call themselves, for me, I think they were the real owners of that land. But then Morocco came in and claimed Kashmir land. So it continues to be a disputed area. The UN peacekeeping is there just to ensure peace in that region. The UN's job is nothing else except to maintain peace. So, and the entire 1700 kilometers of desert is littered with landmines. There was a blueprint when the Spanish left, but then the blueprint is no more valid because the sand dunes shift. You know, every now and then, with the sand dunes shifting, the landmines shift. You don't know where the landmines are. And we have seen, when I was there, every now and then we would see, we would hear that a truck has gone lower because it has stepped onto the landmine. And UN peacekeepers were in those deep desert, several areas, because we had to maintain peace in all the area. Very dangerous. I used to go there, that was the first time also in my life that I ever got into a UN helicopter. Because I was in the finance, and I had to go. Everything was cash transaction. The UN military forces were to be paid in cash. So every month I would take a bag full of US dollars to make payment to those. And then I would see the life that they are living there. I mean, they get comfort, they have AC, they have everything. But then they can't step out. They have to be within that corridor. And they have earmarked, they have themselves earmarked an area about a circumference of maybe 1 kilometer. That's all. Beyond that, they can't venture out. They don't know what is outside that circle. Then the first time when I went, I went in an Antelope, and Antelope is a supplies carrier actually. So there are no seats. You sit on the sides. The supplies are all in the middle, and it's all netted together. So when I went there, the first time, I saw the team side there, and they have these oil drums. They mark it as white. That's the landing area for the Antelope. And I was just looking for a runway. I said, where is the runway? I looked around here and nothing, I don't see a runway. Then I was told, no, there is no runway, the Antelope lands inside. And it's big. And the Antelope was really good. It does not need a long stretch. It's a solid ground. So it was a great experience for me. And then when you go into the camp inside, you find, in the clothes line, there are vipers, snakes. Venomous, I don't know if it was venomous at all, because the team side, the camp, the military people who would patrol the area, they would find, and they were kind of like a souvenir there, it's all on the clothes line. I said, my God, when you look at it, it's quite scary. Long ones, green ones, most of them that kind of like, and the desert, some of the places, the desert can get to 65 degrees during daytime. Hot. They say we can't even touch our tools. It's that hot. And the night becomes freezing. That's the extent of climate change in a day in that kind of an area. Very difficult life. I spent one year there. Then I got back. 1993 that was. No, 91 I was in. 91, I was sent to Damascus for the Gulf War during the first Iraq War. So I was there for about 3 months, and the relief commissioner, the UN relief commissioner, he said, Krish, we have chosen you to do cross-border operations in Baghdad. And I said, my God, the war is non-stop. And I was scared. He said, sorry, I'm not too sure that I... Since I was a permanent staff, I could say no. But there was another UNP, United Nations volunteer. They have to be sent. They can't say no. Or you lose your job in power. You lose your volunteer. So there was another Nepali young fellow, and he was sent instead. But I stayed there. The what we had planned was about 150,000 refugees coming from Iraq to Syria. But that did not happen. Most of them chose to go to Turkey up over north. So with the result that the United Nations Disaster Relief Organization, that was called, they said, okay, let's wind up these operations. The Turkey office can take over. We were getting a trickle of refugees. And the refugees were sent through another seaport to wherever they wanted as an immigrant. So that was part of it. Anyway, I spent about 3-4 months there. And then I said, when it was being wound up, I said, I would go back. I can't do this cross-border operations in Dubai. I went to the relief camps, the refugees camps, and I spoke to the refugees. They get a mere ration per day. You know, but they were so hospitable. They said, you come in, they made me sit there, and they, out of the sugar ration, they would give me tea and whatever they you know. Said, I can't. And then the stories that I heard, they said that my husband was shot dead. They didn't have the courage to pick up the body from the road. That was the scare that was there at that point of time. Anyway, these were experiences that I had. I came back to my... I was always holding my national position. I would never resign, because I knew the moment you resign and join as an international, you would be like a gypsy. You would be sent here and there and everywhere. You would not have any permanent position in one country. So that's the internationals. Like, they don't stay in any country for more than 3 years. And they moved around. So I didn't want to check. I somehow, I don't know, but in 95, I had a tag saying that, okay, he's a disaster man. It's better, let's send him to a disaster area. So I chose that. I said, no, I don't. I purposely said, no, I don't want to be an international for the time being. I would continue to be a national staff. I would hold on to my position. And I would go on a deputation, come back. So that's what I was doing. 93 was the Western Sahara. I came back. Then 98, I was with UNDP all along. In 1998, I got a position, an upward position, as a procurement officer in the United Nations World Food Program. World Food Program at that point had a large operations in India. We had three major programs: Food for Work, Food for Education, and ICDS, Integrated Child Development Scheme, for which we used to buy crores of world commodities. So I was there as a world procurement officer. In that same year, UNWFP, United Nations WFP headquarters in Rome, they came out with a program saying that we need to teach security awareness to all staff, because UN is being targeted more and more, especially the WFP, because we are distributing food in the disaster prone areas and we are targeted. So we need to teach our own staff how to react when such a thing happens. So that program is called the security awareness. And I was trained in Rome as a security awareness trainer. And then that was about a month in Rome, and it was very intense training. And I used to, even at night, I used to dream of those programs. But what I was thinking, I couldn't sleep. I even went to the doctor. I said, doctor, I'm able to sleep. No, because the contents are coming up and rotating in my head. Then he said, no, you need to take a break. You need to go out. You need to see the place. Go around, walk, the normal things. Anyway, it was an intense program. Then immediately they said, okay, you have to go to Africa. Where? Nairobi, Kenya, Somalia, Mozambique, and Uganda. I said, let me go home first. I want at least 15 days break. I'll come back. So they said, fine, that's not a problem. So I went back home, came back, I visited first Kenya. Kenya is a beautiful country, fantastic country, but it's very dangerous. You can be mugged on broad daylight. It happened with my colleague. So you have to be very careful when you go to Kenya. Anyway, we had our 3 days training in we trained all staff on the security awareness program. Then I was with another Irish person, we were a two-member team. And then we went to Uganda. Uganda was not great either. You can't walk outside very freely. You are surrounded. From the hotel room, I found an Indian restaurant, Maharaja of India. This is about 200 meters. So I would walk to that carrying just about $10 in my pocket with nothing else for my food and come back. You know, one day as I was coming, suddenly I found two big fellows behind me. And they suddenly said, hey, give me a cigarette. I said, I don't smoke. Then he says, okay, give us money, we'll buy cigarettes. I said, I don't have money. Maybe I have $1 or not more than that, because I would go just with that money to buy a lunch or a dinner. I wouldn't carry more money because I would, then you are given briefing. So this guy says, the one guy is talking to the other. He says, hey, this guy doesn't smoke, this guy doesn't have money, let's check him out. In the meanwhile, my mind is reacting. I see my hotel on the other side of the road. Uganda is following the left-hand rail. So, and I see oncoming traffic. I can see the gate to my hotel on the other side. I'm planning how to get to the gate. You know? And I got an opportunity. I saw a break in traffic. I just dashed. We are used to in Delhi. You just run. So I avoid it. There's no point in a conflict because there's no way you can't win. The best is to avoid and get out of it. So I went out. Kampala. I was training staff. I mean, there are so many local staff. I don't remember all of them. Anyway, after training one Sunday, I get a call from a local staff. I don't even recognize his name. He says, I'm sorry, but I want you to come for lunch. I was very friendly with everyone. I was very friendly with the local staff, everyone. So I didn't want to disappoint him. I said, where are you? He said, I have sent my girlfriend to pick you up. You know, I was not comfortable. And anyway, I said, I'm going to come, but I'm not going to come in your girlfriend's car. I have my own car, I'm going to come in my own car. When I got to the restaurant, in the big out of town, and I said, this guy, okay, fine. I sat down and I suddenly see the beautiful mountains around. I said, okay, let me take my video camera out and I started shooting. When I went there, I found my colleague, WP staff, was quite drunk. Anyway, I said, okay, let me enjoy the nature. And then about three people surrounded me, tall, really 6 feet, more than 6 feet, 15. This is, what are you doing in their accents, African accent? He said, you are trying to depict Africa as a poor nation. I said, come on, man. I said, friend, I will always call you a friend. He said, come on, friend, I am not depicting anything. This is, I am enjoying your beautiful country. And I want my family to enjoy this. I am taking this for my family, for me, nothing else. The guy says, you break your standard. He said, of course you can do it. I mean, what? I will not be able to stop you. You can break my camera. But you have to believe what I'm saying. I'm enjoying your beautiful country. Yeah, that's what I'm doing. In the meantime, my friend comes, he's drunk already, and he gets into an argument with them. It becomes a bit unruly. I have to step in. I said, you better go and sit there. I will try and talk to them. I talked to them. I said, I was not afraid. Remember, I was never afraid. I said, you have to understand what I'm saying. Eventually, they agreed, okay, I went and sat in my table. But those people were sitting in the next table and always watching me. So I was a bit uncomfortable in there. And moreover, I'm not going to get anything for food. I saw that. You know, they were all getting all kinds of non-veg. Then I said, my friend, I don't eat these things. What is it that can get? Salad. Alright, let's get a plate of salad. When the salad comes, again you find some stuff which I thought was shrimp or something like that. And then I said, no, I think I need to go. I told him, I said, no, I'm not comfortable here and I'm not getting anything for it. Please don't mind. Let's have lunch in the office tomorrow. He said, I can get a sandwich. You know? So we wriggle out again. My security awareness training helped me get out of these tough situations. And then when I got, the next thing only I heard that the next door restaurant was bombed just about 15 days back. I didn't know that. So you get into such difficult situations, but you need to be aware of your situation and manage. You know, if you become scared, then you will not be able to manage anything. I found Swami, especially after 95, when he became a sevadar, with me all the time, with me. My wife will pack Swami's photograph first in my bag. This is the first thing that you have to pack. An A4 photograph of Swami, still with me, everywhere. And a heap full of, package full of devotee, I would carry it. And the Swami's photograph will be in my office table. I do not care whether somebody likes it or not. Then my Swami comes with me and he is there in my office table. Many people of us come and ask, who is this? I just said, he is God to me. And one lady reacted, especially one Ethiopian lady. She says, I don't believe. Did I say that you have to believe him? Do you believe in Jesus Christ, right? Similarly, he is my God. I am not going to get into an argument. You believe in Jesus Christ, believe in my God, that's it. Period. Nothing else. So people have come. People have like what I have said. You know, it's very difficult to explain. You have to see what Swami has done for mankind. I've said, Google it. Look at the website. See what Swami has done. The education institutions, the health care that Swami has provided free to the humanity. These are to be seen to be believed, not heard, just put here. So many of them, they like it. And I always make it a point to give them vibhuti, whether they like it or not. I just tell them, if you are sick, if you are feeling unwell, just take it. Ash. They will say, oh, Ash, you are giving me Ash. For me, this is a very powerful Ash. If you want to name it as Ash, this is very powerful. And I have felt myself that it takes me out of the trouble, it cures me, and I'm feeling low. So, if you don't want to take it, perfect, leave it. But then people have come. People have come, staff, local staff, who are not Indian nationals, have come, saying, you know, I think there is a problem with my child. Can I take some of them? Please do. No? That's why. So that was Kambal. And then I come to 2001. You all heard about the Bhuj earthquake. I was again tagged and they said, okay, we need to go rush. I said, fine. When we landed in Ahmedabad and we drove to Bhuj, we reached Bhuj in the evening around 30 or so. And on my way, when we entered Bhuj area, I had never seen something like this before. I mean, I have, everywhere you see only fires burning. How do you fathom this kind of thing? You don't imagine a situation like that. I'm in the car, I'm looking on my left, I'm looking on my right, burning. And then I said, what have I got into? Anyway, we reached Bhuj. There are not a single building was safe. So we were given by the relief commissioner a park to stay. At that point of time, the relief officer said, the tents are being dispatched, you would get it. I got it 2 days later. So me and my colleague slept in the vehicle for 2 days. We didn't even get chai. Nothing was available. Of course we were warned, you need to take a lot of dilations. You need to drink, right? Something hot or something. Anyway, there was no mobile connection, nothing. No, nothing was working. We were handed over a sat phone from the office. So I called. Usually I used to call my wife. My wife will say, oh, Swaminarayan temple is providing food. Somewhere. She says, you have to find out where. We did. My wife, my colleague and we both looked for it and then we saw a big queue there. And we stood in the queue. We said, we're getting at least rice and dal. So that game we enjoyed. But that trip was excellent because UN was getting enormous supplies from abroad, all over, relief supplies. They were excellent stuff. And our job was logistics. We had to clear the entire consignment. Every day the plane road would come. We spent all day in the airport, make sure that the relief supplies are clear and sent to the respective agencies' warehouse. Once it happened, I was told from Delhi, the Antonov, which was coming with full of relief supplies, it landed in Ahmedabad. And then my office people said, you rush to Ahmedabad and clear the flight. So I rushed. It's about 7 hours, right? So we went to Ahmedabad and I see Antonov standing there. And I asked the pilot, the guy can't speak a word of English. And he's showing me the manuscript. He says, Ahmedabad. And I speak over the phone to my Delhi. I said, look, he's not willing to go. And he says, his manuscript says, the point of the word, the dispatcher is Ahmedabad or whatever. Then they said, okay, we'll clarify now the supply. They got back and then they said, oh, Krishna, you can't go beyond Ahmedabad. Now you have to clear this here and take it to Kutch. Okay, I said, fine, I go to the relief commissioner who is providing free trucks to the UN. I said, fine, we load that. In the meantime, I said, I go to a restaurant. I want to at least get some breakfast and come. So we went, again, two of us were there. We went and while coming back, for some reason I saw trucks moving on the road. And for some reason, I said, this looks like our supplies. And I stopped the trucks. I said, kahan ja rahe ho, where are you? I asked them to show all the details. It's definitely meant for WFP, which. And they said, kahan leke ja rahe ho? He said, warehouse leke jaane ke liye bola. He said, no, warehouse nahi jayega, ye kuch jayega. I said, it will go to kuch after any warehouse. It was another because the relief commissioner, the previous evening, had retired, his duty was over. Just tough situation, my friend. Make him understand this is not for warehouse here. It is meant to be taken to Kutch. After about 3 or 4 hours of negotiations and talk, several phone calls, actually we managed to get it out of rolling towards Kutch. And then it was went to several agencies. The WFP operations started and we had to get a lot of food. Where do we store? They said, okay, find a place. So I was talking around. I found a nice small area, like larger than this. But it was so uneven. It had to be cleared, it had to be made because we had to erect our vehicles where we can store our food grains, food materials. That took another time. Then I had to look for some tractor kind of a thing in which eventually found out. What I carried, I said, okay, let's go, tick kijiye, level kijiye. He says, I need water. So he says, talk to the relief commissioner. I went back to the relief commissioner, I said, I need tankers, at least 2 tankers full of water. And suddenly he said, Pani to mil jayega, we will get water. You know, ek tank chahiye. So, it's kind of a bargain, but it all meant for good purpose only. It is not that it was going to be used or anything. They wanted for some poor people. We had fantastic heating tents. The major, the goal of those tents was to make sure that the children go to school. It will be erected as a school, and children can go because you need to get out of that mentality. You're in a trance. With us. So it's a massive earthquake, you have to understand. Massive. Everything was flawed. I went through the Bachao and Anji, two villages where about 400 people were just buried under the road. They were 26 jungle. They were marching through those lanes. The whole building crumbled on them. Gone, just by. There was an Air Force building. Air Force staff quarters. On that day, the children were in the school doing parade. parents just gone. How many orphans? My friend and I was walking. He said, "Yeah, you appreciate who's taking it." You know, the board of the shop was on the like on the one floor down. We looked and I said, "Look, this building, one floor is one inside." That was how the disaster was. I spent almost 1 month there, and 2000, I was waiting for my visa for Iraq. And then my manager said, "Well, you go and manage Bhuj first, and then we'll see." So it was very tough, even in Bhuj. Then, as I got back in 2001, this was about end of February, I got my visa. Then I went to Iraq. Iraq was another. The program was good, very satisfying. We did a lot of work, but then dangerous. Iraq, the UNDP was entrusted with network rehabilitation program, electricity network rehabilitation. Electricity was non-existent because of the continuous 9 years of war between Iran and Iraq. Electricity was just not there. No grid, nothing. Every lane they had a generator, a huge generator providing electricity, and you could see the wires like cobwebs, you know. So UNDP was interested with the rehabilitation. $2 million, one of the largest contract UNDP handling. So I was in one of the governorates. Very difficult to work in Pakistan. Briefing, when you get a security briefing, we were very clearly told, you don't shout, you don't argue with a contractor. And when you hire a staff, you always have the national program officer with you to hire. Because if you shout a little bit more, then they pull out a gun and shoot. It was that dangerous. So you are given proper briefing. But for some reason, with my Swami on the table, everywhere, even in Iraq, my first table, Swami on photograph and my desk calendar will go everywhere with me. The yearly Swami's calendar, desk calendar. I would never leave them. I would not worry. The so-called minister, external affairs minister, there, the self-proclaimed, she calls me and she says, "Oh, you were supposed to come and give me your profile." I said, "Ma'am, my focal point is planning minister, and I've already met him. I did not see any reason for me to come and give you my profile. If I had to come, I would definitely would have done. But I'm in touch with the Prime Minister and I'm doing my work. There's no problem. We have this vehicle. It's a huge program, as I said. The projects, so many projects, and we need vehicles for the projects. So we had a contract of about every 6 months we have a contract of $250,000. Just for the contractor to provide vehicles to us. So one fine day, the guy stops providing vehicles. And then the project manager comes to us and shouts, "What happened, Krish? We are not getting vehicles and it's a $500,000 implementation loss." That's how they talk. They don't understand. Anyway, I speak to the contractor. He says, "The fuel prices have gone up, so I have to increase the rate by 20%. I said, "No, that's not done. We have a 6 months contract, no cost increase. It is not agreed terms between you and me. So there is nothing. So you have to continue to provide. You can increase your cost when the next tender comes after 6 months." It was not okay. They did not agree. Then I get instructions. This is not my company, so I get instructions. I got instructions, cancel this contract, give it to the next lowest, as them to provide. So I did that. I canceled the contract in writing. The next day, about 10 people came outside the office with guns, firing in the air. The guard comes running, he says, "Look, you don't know, there are a lot, but they're very angry. Iraqi, the way they speak English. He was not scared. I get a call from a UN, you know, in the UN, in Iraq, it was the UN Guards Contingency. They were the people who provide security for us. So they call me, the secrets we just heard, you don't step out. We are coming. Until we come, you don't step out. No, I'm not scared. Why should I stay? They're not going to shoot me like that, just like that. So I went out. I went out and I said, I see, they're really getting a little bit of this. I said, the contractor, I saw him, I said, you can bring two more people. Not all of them. And no guns inside the complex. Come inside, we talk. He came inside, he says, I told him, I said, I gave you a warning, I gave you in writing. You should have come and talked to me. You did not. I called you. You did not. So, I said, this is not my company I'm running. I have instructions. I have rules to follow. So, my friend, you have lost your chance. This is how I used to talk to him. Then my friend, you lost it. Now you have to wait. He's after all those things, he says, okay, I will provide vehicles for tomorrow. I said, no, done. Your contract is cancelled. It's not fair. I said, now you've lost it. You wait for another 3 months. The contract will come up for another renewal tendering. You meet your terms, and if you are the winner, fine, you get it. So I did not budge from my position. But in the back of your mind, you always have that threat perception. Because they can do anything. But then, I was holding on to Swami. Always, I had Swami with me everywhere. I said, even I used to wonder, why am I being kidnapped, you know, tonight? I have a feeling. But I said, no, I saw him there watching me. In my house also, I would have Swami's calendar. Very good. All along, I said, as I said before, Swami has always been guiding me in very different positions, I tell you. And people would, buckle up. The kind of a situation that you are in Somalia. 2004, I came back in 2003, after 2 years of my contract, came back. And within 3 months, 6 months, they said, okay, Somalia. I said, all right, go, let's go back. My wife says, Swami's program, we will be back. My daughter will be back, the ready-made tomato rice, ready-made pongal. I got used to it by then. So she would call the vendor. Is it okay, 7 ready-made pongal, 7 ready-made tomato rice? Because in the UN, in disaster, these kind of countries, I get a 1 week leave every 6 weeks. So she would calculate, this is okay, 42 days. So we pack. That's all, nothing else. Somalia. Okay, they said, don't raise your voice, security briefing. Don't raise your voice, because every street has a warlord. It is so unruly. The UN had programs only in the north, Hargeisa and around that. In the south, Mogadishu was still under the militia programs. So very dangerous to even cross over that side. So we were in south, fine. Again, similar thing, contract came up. We had a donor giving us about $250,000. So I don't take a decision on my own, no. We discuss with the project people, project managers. Project managers, we discuss, okay, what best can we do this $300,000? And mind you, we have to give, for each dollar, we have to give an account to the donors. It's their money, it's not our money. So it has to be used in the best interest. So it's not even a single local staff in our office. I'm talking to the project managers who are all internationals. They're saying, what can we do? $300,000, what is the best? Then somebody suggested, we build a community center to this place because they don't even have a place to bring their wares, the agricultural wares to sell. So we said, fine, it was all agreed. I don't know, within 3 days, I get 5 people, including a warlord, a strong man, 106-year-old guy. Very strong. You don't think that 106 is dead. They are very strong. Very strong, and he also brought his son along with him. And he tells me, this is very, very happy, of course, through my admin officer who translates. Also, we are very happy UNDP is going to build a community center for us. So he is the contractor. He tells me, that person sitting there, he is the contractor. I said, I will listen to you fully. after I listen to you, then you have to listen to me. That is what we agree. I listened to him. I said, okay, let him speak. So after, when he finished, I said, excellent, I am happy that you have a contractor. But I hope you know that we have rules. We can't pass the rules. He said, last year, UNHCR, United Nations Humanitarian Relief Commission, they brought a similar contractor from outside and he was shot dead. I mean, are you threatening me? I said, I didn't ask my national visitor to translate. He said, don't threaten me, because if you threaten me, you won't get this community center in your office. Because they will transfer me to the Nairobi, our central program office. Nothing will happen to me. I will leave. They will transfer me. But your community center will also go. I made him understand. I was always talking with full respect, with love, and address them nicely. I said, you have to understand my position. This is not my organization. We have rules. We have to follow the rules. And then I took him to my own office. I said, you look at my office, all basement, everything. Now you tell me what is wrong in this building. He said, the floor is not good. The floor is uneven, the tiles are so uneven. I said, exactly. I don't want this contractor to build another floor like this. It is a contract for building a community center. I said, I need to account for every penny to the donor. I want to build a center which will last for at least 50 years, if not more. At least for 50 years, you should have this building. That's my mission. So, I don't want this floor. The contractor, he says, I ran out of the tiles. So, he brings in some other color tiles and fixes. So, there's no symmetry, nothing. And the tiles are not smooth. One is jutting out. It's dangerous. You can trip. And it will rip apart in no time. I said, this is what I don't want. His son was very aggressive. His son was continuously talking in Somali language, even kind of fighting with his father, trying to take control of that. But then there in Somalia, the warlord, whatever they speak, is the final. They are the chief. I took a little advantage of that, actually. I told them, I said, we need to speak separately. I do this, son. I said, I told him, I said, you are much younger. You are much younger to me. Your father is so old. Your father is so experienced in this life. He has seen fighting all his life. Somalia has been under militia attack for centuries. So I said, you have to understand. He has experience. You don't do all these things. At least don't fight in front of a meeting, in a group. You can always argue. We argue at home with my wife. We don't bring it out. So the point is, I took a kind of a little advantage. He fell for it. The father says, I keep telling this guy and he doesn't listen to me. He became a very good friend of mine. Even before the contract, of course, they didn't get the contract. The contractor that he said was not. He didn't have any experience, nothing. I told him, I will include him in my roster. That's the only thing that I can do. I got him included in my roster. The documents were sent. He had no experience of even voting. So there is no question of, awarding a contract to them. But the old man used to come to me. Every now and then he would come and I said, I felt bad. I said, look, you are very old. You don't do that. If you want to meet me, tell me, I will come to your village. You build these places, you build a very good rapport with them. You talk to them, you respect them. That works. And more, what is more important was, in Somalia, Indians were respected as such. Why? Because the Indian army was there as a peacekeeping operation. And they left an incredible mark, doing all this excellent work. And of course, that's why I'm proud to be an Indian. So that was in my favor, actually. They said, oh, Indians, yes. So they had a natural respect for Indians also. So I again returned out of that kind of situation without any fear, really. They said, I stood for Swami's principles. You need to be very straight. You need to be honest. And of course, I will not go bypass my rules. that is not there at all. So I got out of that. Then I, in Iraq, I want to go back. The war was looming. You know? We knew that. For 6 months we were planning. We said, okay, the war is going to be any time. And we kept on planning. Contingency, UN keeps on planning. We, now and then, we would plan. That was one of the security focus points. And we had more than 2,000 staff. We had to reduce it to number. You know, manage it. When you evacuate, you can't take 2,000 people along with you. So you need to bring it down to a manageable level. So we said, okay, we expected, we were anticipating in 6 months' time the war might come. So we said, okay, October, November onwards, we started reducing our staff. We staff again 6 weeks when staff go on leave, we said, don't come, you stay there. All paid, everything, their salaries, everything is paid. Don't come until we tell them. So that's why, you know, you don't have to be very obvious because everybody gets a notice of it. And then people get, the local staff will get worried and so on. So we managed it so very well. And we, the last few months, the last month was more less than 100 people there. And that was manageable. Four, you know, that was perfectly fine. We had to do a security drill, evacuation drill, by driving our own vehicle, large Land Cruiser, to different locations. Iran was closest. So I had to drive a vehicle. When I say closest, it's 300 kilometers. So I had to drive a Land Cruiser. Of course, the driver is there, but you have to drive. Because you need to know the road conditions. You need to know the routes. In case you can't, the original agreement between the UN, New York, and Baghdad was all international staff will go through Baghdad. That was the agreement. But in case of an eventuality, you need to get out of Iran, which is closest to the Soleimani and the governorate that I was in. Doha was another governorate. Turkey was the closest point there. So people should know the exit routes. I went there. I drove heavy snowfall and about 3 feet of snow, the slippery, mountainous. We came up to, we drove, it took maybe 6 hours. We came back to the Iranian border, and suddenly the Iranian border thought we are going to cross over, and they're pointing their guns at us. Started pointing their guns at us. Then said, sorry, can somebody speak English? We need to explain. We're not here to cross over. They didn't understand. There was nobody who could understand. Of course, we're not going to go anywhere. We're going to come over. We just need to know the routes so that. Then when I got back, I called out with the security officer. I said, what kind of an information that you are passing on to Iran and Turkey? They don't even know that in case of an emergency, we are going to cross over. So they should be ready about it. So they didn't know. I said, my friend, get over to New York and get the, all these instructions there. But this is not going to work if something happens. They're coming at us with guns. You know? So we need to act ourselves first. So we got that. And then the last the day of the 3 days before, the financial controller says, we got the orders in New York, and in three days later you're evacuated. And then the financial controller calls me and he says, Vish, how much money you have? Everything was cash dollars. Everything. There was no bank, nothing. I said, I have over $100,000 in my cash. He says, how much can you reduce it? I said, I don't know. I have to ask my project officers because they are the people who are implementing the project. So we had a meeting, called the project officers. Project officers says, I have more than $100,000 payment ready, but I don't have anybody to do documentation. I said, I'm there, documentation. I will do documentation for you. We had to be very discreet in our own operations because we did not want the local staff to know as much as possible. Because they will all get worried, they will know that we are leaving. However, what they didn't know was that we had planned everything, all the local staff, 3 months' salaries were packed in an envelope and in my office chest. That was all done. That is very clear UN rules. So we had to do all those things overnight, and the next day we had to call one contractor at a time, not all of them. So they would all get customer noticed that anyway we managed to reduce it to about $30,000 or $40,000, I don't remember. We had to take that cash. The last day they said, okay, today, go. And then the financial contact, hey, don't forget the hard disk. Forget the hard disk. Don't forget. Okay, fine, take it. And then we left. And on our way from Sulaimaniyah to Baghdad was about 4 hours. Right. The exit route was through Baghdad. As we were going, we could see they were also ready. And the tanks, the huge tanks, were buried under. Only the nozzle was jutting out. We could see the nozzle. We know and there is a nozzle over the ground. And then from Baghdad to Jordan border, that was the route. It's 900 kilometers. Beautiful road made by Japan 25 years back. Fantastic. You know? And it's kind of a stream. It just turns a bit here and there. All along desert, nothing else. Just desert. And what these people had done, they did cement, you know, solid cement blocks every half a kilometer. So the car had to go like this. You know? Reason? The war planes can land there. So they were also prepared. They knew it was coming. So we wait through all those blocks, reached on maybe night, late night, early morning the bombs came. And the war broke out. So, you know, so if you are a weak-hearted person, it can impact. You can have, you would not be able to handle kind of situation. I was nowhere, I was afraid. Except, of course, the threat perception is there, night you can dream, you know, I might be kidnapped, stuff like that. So that's all a part of it, but then I just did my work very well. However, you know, the local staff are our counterparts, so you need to respect them. That's the most bare. It is not Iraq or any. Even in India, it's very important for us to respect the local staff because we are all dependent on them. Everybody is dependent on them. Together only we are implementing some program. But that was, it was all through experience I learned. As I said, I did not get any major formal education in law. That was true. And then 2004 was over. Yeah. In Delhi, I came back to New York. This was in World Food Program. So we organized a conference, a regional conference. So we were joined by many foreigners. One German came to my office and he saw Swami's photograph. He said, oh, Swami's photograph. He was so happy. Oh, my wife is a devotee. I said, fine. I picked up from my bag. Even now, my bag has several devotee packets. I picked up some devotee packet, gave it to him. You know what he said? He says, my wife said somebody is going to give you a devotee packet. I'm telling you, I'm getting goosebumps when I think about it. He says, first he says, oh, my wife is a devotee. And then he says, when I gave him the vibhuti, some wife says, before leaving you, somebody is going to give you the vibhuti. How do you explain this? You can't explain. You have to believe Swami is always with you. And you are doing a right, good job. You do not worry. The belief is more important than anything else. You don't have to understand. You forget about it. Nobody can understand Swami. It's beyond us. We are just very, very small. Nothing. You don't even comprehend why. Just keep him in your faith. That's the most important thing. My wife was much more, she was a devotee much before I became, even before. And she was the one who prompted me. He says, okay, let's go to Patti. Let's go to Patti. But we got married in 1987. And we made a trip. Somebody in my office, consultant, he wrote a letter to Chakravarti sir. I didn't understand anything anyway. I came to the vehicle that gate. And they read through that and something, I don't remember what he said. So either Chakravarti sir was not there or something like that. We didn't even step inside the prison. Just imagine, come to Puttaparthi. Of course, I knew nothing about it. I said, fine, my wife is insisting. Okay, let's go. 1987. 1971, my mother has always been a devotee. 1971, I don't know, I think it was 1971, because my mother said, so I heard Swami is here in Delhi. Please take me to have his darshan. I said, yes, we go. We would. She was everything for us. So we would never say no to him. And he said, fine, go. I was still in school. That's why he said, I think it was 1971 or so. And that was the first time I saw him in the state president's bungalow. But I could not get into Swami's world until 1995. Even in 87, nothing. So the thing is, there are how many millions of people in our country? How many people can come here? It's all his will. If he does not will it, everybody has the time. You have a time. You can come only on this time, during this time. Not earlier, not later. I mean, we reached the gate, but we did not step in. I was a bit impatient. Probably that was the reason my wife turned back. Because we had only a few hours, Bangalore, and then we had to get back. But look at that. Can you beat it? I was there, right there at the stove, step, and he wouldn't take me. He wouldn't say, no, it's not time for you to come. Go back. 1995, I became a sevadar. And there has been no turning back. I never missed my seva, Bharti Seva from Delhi, or any other seva for that matter, in Delhi. So, again, it's a strong faith that you build in yourself. My mother has sacrificed all her life for us. Otherwise, she would have said at that time, if we had the means, she would have said, okay, take me to Bharti. But where is the mean? There is nothing at home. Eight mouths to be fed during the time. So she came silently. She wouldn't even talk to us about it. So that kind of sacrifice she went through. After 2004, I came back to WAP, and within a few months they said, okay, Kabul is in trouble. The UNDP office is in, they need an immediate person. Okay. I mean, I got a 1 year contract. It was actually there was a staff who was not able to handle the international staff payroll. I was trained in Copenhagen. I said, okay, fine, I go. But I could not stay more than 6 months because of the incompetency of my boss. I said, no, I can't stay here anymore. So I called back my office. I said, I'm coming back. I said, I can't work. But the internationals were very happy to go there. Within 3 months, I talked about everything. 2 years pending work. No problem at all. But then I had the problem with my boss. I said, no, I can't work under these conditions. We left them. 2006 and 7, I was in India. 2008, I got an opportunity as a TDY, temporarily TDY. In Dubai. Dubai is a largest humanitarian base, logistics base for World Food Program. For that matter, any agency. We have a massive amount of stockpile. And any problem anywhere near in the region, we can send supplies immediately. So there, I was there for about 4 months. Came back. That was in 2009 onwards, WAP started shrinking rapidly because we work in tandem with the government of India. If the government does not want us, obviously we can't be here. So the government of India said, you can close the Food for Education program. Because they were the, actually what is this thing, WAP can do only certain, only up to that much. And then the scaling up is the state government's responsibility, which was not being done. So then they said, okay, we will take over and Food for Education can be closed. Food for Education work was also closed at the same time. Then the only program left was ICDS. And for ICDS, we did not want this big structure. again, there was a lot of negotiations on the staff reduction. A lot of people came from headquarters. I volunteered and I said, you know, this is enough. I will leave. You give me a package and I go. I got a package, I got my package. Then I joined Satya Sai Vidya Vahini. Again, a coincidence, how Swami makes it happen, you know. I was in Bhakti Seva, I was in this, most of the time I was in general canteen. And many times I have asked, I never got a hospital Seva. I used to ask, I said, why don't you send me to hospital, my Seva will coordinate. He said, okay, yes, you close the canteen and go. I'm like, come on, no, I would never ask you. I said, fine, he wants me there, I was very happy doing Seva in Chennai. General canteen, what happens is, the ladies canteen has, we exchange. When they run up short of, some food stuff, we send it across. So this lady came across from there, she says, we need some stuff. I said, fine, we have something sent up there. Then I was talking to the manager's office, and they said, there is a problem in the ladies canteen. There's something wrong. So can you speak to the Seva Dal coordinator? And I said, who is the Seva Dal coordinator? I don't know. He said, oh, the lady who just came. And I said, okay, no problem, I will speak what the front, because she's also from Delhi. I don't know her personally. I said, okay, I will. So when I spoke, she said there was an issue with the Seva Dals and also she wanted to go. Then we were talking. We had a coffee and we were talking. And she said she was doing a lot of work on nutrition, like manna powder and all. And then she heard that I was with the World Food Program. She says, I need some videos on nutrition. I said, yes, that is not possible. That is not a problem, I feel. And then I told her, I said, I have only 1 month, I'm leaving. And then she says, no, sir, before you leave. I said, even after I leave, I will get it, not an issue. My staff, my friends are there, get it. Then she says, what are you going to do, sir? In the meantime, the Seva Dal coordinator had already talked to me and he says, you're going to take care of the Sai Center in Delhi. I had agreed. I said, yes, I'm going to be free, I will be happy to do whatever. Then she said, no, no, sir, we need you in Vidya Vahini. I said, okay, Vidya Vahini, but I told her, I said, don't expect a PhD at all, I'm not. If you're expecting that, you're knocking the wrong door. But she said, no, 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 sir, nothing of that kind. We need a person like you, experience coordination. So that's how I joined Vidya Vahini, and I spent some fantastic time with Vidya Vahini, including one week training in Kodaikanal. Unbelievable. Sai Shruti, Swami's room, especially when we went into Swami's room for the first time, I've never been so close. You know the monkey mind, it's a closed door. We are all trooping silently. And we see the Judah swinging a bit. And I thought maybe I'm my perceptions, you know, it's my mind is making it. Then I see the Judah swinging. And then I look up, I saw maybe a fan is on. We are entering a locked room. Then I said, maybe a window is open. And he's there. He's there amongst us. It's just that we fail to notice. We fail to understand. I have video. I have taken video. How many people have shown? So fantastic. So beautiful. That kind of an experience. Then 2018, I had my dream. I had an opportunity to go to Kailash Mansarovar, organized by the government of India. So we went. The government of India organized trips for every year, and always a liaison officer from the government is sent along with the group to liaise with the Chinese authorities in case of any issues. And this time I had a very high ranking official from Karnataka state. She was a wonderful lady. And then I had my bag, you have to have your passport, your money, everything staying here. And then on top of it, the transparent bag, I have my Vibhuti packets. And then she noticed, she says, Swami, Krishna, are you Swami Devotee? Yes, ma'am. That is it. So we had endless bhajan sessions throughout our trek. you just imagine, Swami connects you even at that kind of a place. Very different, right? And to tell you, very different. But then when you go and see in front of the, stand in front of the Mount Kailash for the, it's just amazing. It's it dwarfs the mount, the mounts around it. It's a story, and unexplored till date. You get that vibration there. My wife said, you must see the Sai where Shiva Bhajan there. Of course I did. I recorded it. You can hardly breathe because you can't speak for too long. 19,000 feet. Then we come down to Mansarovar Lake, another beauty. Gauri Kund at the level of 18,000 feet. Pristine, blue and greenish water. These are Devlokan hotels. Amazing places. Again, Swami, look at the connect that he made on our trip. It made things so easier for us. I mean, I was a friend to her, she was a friend to me, and we both connected with Swami, and the entire stretch was about Swami. We would talk hours and hours. She was a very high level officer and connected. Then came, there was a flood in Ludhiana, a small village got flooded because HP released the dam, opened the dam gates, heavy rainfall, and then the village was flooded, and then they requested some people from Delhi. I was immediately there. Those days I had a severe back pain, I have a perennial back problem. Severe back pain, but my wife said, how are you going to go? I said, I'm going to go, Swami's call. That's it. We went, it was about 4,000 acres of land completely submerged, and the district administration was nowhere to be seen. Anyway, we were about 60 people, what can we do? Much. So we said, okay, we went and we identified a small school. We did clear the entire about 6 rooms in 3 days. 3 inches of slush, rainwater. 3 inches. As you go, you just slip back. And mosquitoes is not in millions. You open the door, it hits you like a ball. Mosquitoes. But we made it. We did it. And that was recorded as a video program for some village education program or something, which was streamed in Bharti also. What I'm saying is, I'm ready for Seva. Return. Then recently, I watched a wonderful program. It was a Sathya Sai media presentation program. On the title is Little Known Stories About This Hospital. How many of you know about this hospital? Really? This was a beautiful program. A conversation with Mr. Rajan Su, who was one of the 3 architects to build this hospital. So it's beautiful. It was a 2-episode program. And he says, a couple of things caught my eye. He said, Swami, when he called Rajan Su, he said, have you seen Buckingham Palace? Swami said, Rajan said, yes, Swami, I've seen it. He says, I want this hospital to be like a Buckingham Palace. I can assure you that this hospital does look like the palace, very simple. The second thing that Swami said, Rajan Su, for if you don't know, he was an alumni. He is an alumni, sorry. So he says, second thing, the dome height was 75 per day. He says the dome height has to be 75 feet. And from where? On the first floor of the building. I mean, these are small nuances, not many people know about it, until it comes from the architect kind of a process model. You know, that was a beautiful program, that 2 episodes, you should watch. This is your hospital, you should watch about it. So I was very happy, I said, oh, I watched it and I must mention. But in the last 2 days, not 2 days, I would say a few hours that I used to get, I used to just think about it and make jot down. Finally, 2020, I was in Bharti because my daughter was in the National Leadership Program, the first organized by the Institute, the first ever National Leadership Program. She was there for a 3-day orientation program. So I was there with her and we had wonderful darshan and summit. The last last day of a stay, of our stay, after the evening darshan, they just shut everything. They closed everything. And then, of course, the following day, following morning, we were leaving. So we left to Delhi. And within a week of that, 20th March, I think, the lockdown was announced, the pandemic set in. How Swami gives you that opportunity, you have to understand. Keep a lookout for these small opportunities, you have to grab it. It's, you know, the adversity of the pandemic was converted into a fantastic advantage by us. How? We were wondering what to do. Online, I mean, nothing, you can't step out. Suddenly one Swami student said, we were in the Satya Sai Vidya Vahini group. Suddenly one Swami student said, you know, I will stop teaching Rudra to you all of you. I had that Shruti book for 5-6 years in me. And I knew every time my book would open, the first I can't read beyond 2 lines. I said, my God, I can't. You know, I used to feel ashamed because in Bhakti, I used to sit in the chair and I would see foreigners around me chanting, I mean, so beautifully without looking at the book. And I used to feel so ashamed. I said, what the hell am I doing here? I can't even do this. And these people don't even know the language. They're chanting so perfectly. But then the time came now, 2020. When he said, we all chanted. And within a 1 year span, we learned the entire rhythm by heart. I would never have done it, would have done it. I still feel that it's like a dream. It is nothing but Swami's blessings. And I chant Rudra almost every day. Because my daughter said, you have such a wonderful opportunity, go and chant Rudra verse in the morning. So the difficult period was converted into such a great advantage for us by the opportunity given by Swami. You can't get it otherwise. This, you know, you just don't. Anyway, I have also enrolled for Sanskrit classes online and I've done one course because I want to understand a little better. And my course is continuing. Last year, again, another fantastic opportunity gave me. As I said in the beginning, I never got an opportunity to do hospital seva. Again, the lady we met in Seva canteen, the general canteen, when we talked about something, she said, Krish, they are looking for volunteers for the helpline. I said, I don't know anything, what do I do? You know, then she explained to me, I will connect you to the person, he will explain to you, they will give you a training. So last April, I got this another, I mean, Swami has given me a seva. I'm sitting at home, my table, I have my breakfast on the table. You know, what else can you ask for? You're sitting in the comfort of your home doing online such a fantastic seva. I was enjoying that seva. Then the opportunity came again. They said, okay, volunteers who want to come and do on-site seva are also welcome. I grabbed it. I said, I've been planning this for 3 months, but for some reason or other, I could not get here till recently. So the last 10 days I've been here, sitting at the gate, giving appointments. The biggest advantage that I find is, when you speak over the phone, you don't see a face. You just hear what they say. But here, I see them. You know? And I can tell you that 99% of them are children. They're really in need of medical care. You know, one person is there, definitely. They just come and do whatever they want to do, tourism or whatever. But you can't avoid it. 99% of them are children, and I see their faces, and I see, my God, you don't realize they've come from such a far distance, thousands of kilometers. And then they say, I can't stay here for so long because I don't have money. Do you address this? So, I have enjoyed every minute Swami has given me this portion. No, this is another, this is not going to stop. I'm going to continue this seva forever, as long as they need it. It's an amazing work. Finally, I would like to come back to our family. My family is small, like I have a wife and my daughter. My daughter has done MBA economics and is working in Delhi. She's a much more devotee than me. She wants only Swami. She says, Swami, Swami, Swami. She says, I will leave my job and come over here. When I describe the place and all those beautiful hall and all, she says, oh, I'm coming. So you come and Swami calls you. Can't step in otherwise. And my wife is an economics graduate. She left her job, a high, very great job, American Express job, just again sacrificed, when I come to sacrifice. She sacrificed for me because I was traveling and she had to give up her job to take care of my daughter. So they both have, in a sense, sacrificed a lot for me because I did not see my daughter grow. Most of the time I was out. And they both sacrificed so much for me. So I have to, Swami's presence, I have to definitely thank both of them from my heart. I think I'm exhausted. And I would appreciate if there are any questions. Please feel free to ask anything. Yeah. Every question is good enough. You don't have to be there about this. No, this is last one. I really wanted to thank the director, sir, the entire staff of this hospital, and I won't forget my help desk coordinators for making this happen, to come for me to come here and do on-site seva. I'm enjoying my stay. I'm enjoying my the hospitality that you have given me. I don't think I can forget this. This is a fantastic opportunity that Swami has given me. I have to thank Swami from my bottom of my heart. Thank you for patiently listening to me. And it has been a great pleasure. Thank you, sir.
And thank Bhagwan for the privilege of this satsang. So one question may be a philosophical question. You have seen so much diversity in terms of people, like the Somali warlords, the Iraqi troops, the people in the villages in the Western Sahara, and we know at the core that there is one Atman and different manifestations in physical form with the overlay of the, you know, the mind and the emotions called the sheaths. So how did you, apart from your intellect, relating to them for the nature of the work, did you ever think of who is the soul who is in this particular location? What is their destiny? What is going to happen? And thoughts of that nature. It will be interesting to know whether, you know, you were given Bhagavan's gift of fearlessness. It's not given to everybody. But at the same time, because of that, maybe you had a thought to think about some of these things that might have occurred to you. So it will be interesting to know what you thought of all this diversity.